You see my screen?
Not yet, but it's coming. Yes, I see it.
Thank you. I'll try to be brief. This, the results of my research and review of literature for quite some time in the last year. So, what do we have right now if we consider semantic web community, which is normally should be concerned with knowledge graphs, ontologies, and so on? We have a lot of big knowledge graphs, common sense, specialist graphs, but potentially it's a trove of information, but we have very little reasoning, very little conclusions from this information. And this, what is even more interesting, the research even in the semantic web community often turns to statistical methods, embedded neural networks when it is necessary to produce conclusions. So normally knowledge graphs and all this must be great for symbolic reasoning, but somehow it never happened. I deliberately took a couple of examples from semantic web conferences, so they weren't specifically targeted neural networks. The problem of using neural networks in reasoning to produce final conclusions in reasoning is their poor stability and their vulnerability to adversarial examples. The most often metrics we see are tied to percent of success. But what we rarely see when assessing neural networks is severity of errors. And this is important metric when we use it for practical application. We maybe it's better to have more errors, but less severe errors. One very good error is can spoil a lot. So, in practice, this comes that neural networks are capable errors of any magnitude that human intelligence normally doesn't produce. Here are a few examples of my experimenting with GPT-2 based language text generator in English. GPT-2 is called a language model, but when look at more closely, it seems to weren't able to be capturing even simple language features. For example, given a boy as a subject in the first sentence, it does think a boy is a kind of person and user a in the subsequent features, having no idea what articles mean. So we can see phrases like a boy's fathers and even a boy's fingers disregarding the another moment that is evident, it can generate pronouns with no reference. For example, it can generate sentence, the girl smiled and looked to his father, but in the previous sentences, there were only women. So there was no reference to his, no male person to reference. But this language model weren't able. When it comes to narrative logics, it's downright bad. Here are a few examples that are simply impossible and very easily detected as such by human minds. The cough ate their own blood. I agree, it was bad. They laid on each other, which is practically impossible, and it completely messes everything up when dealing with relationships in the family. What is more concerning, it has similar problems with generating sex scenes without any interest in the age of participants. It just doesn't take it into account, simply triggered by verbs like kiss and so on. From the time I wrote this article, they were gathered this winter, I was able to experiment with a lot more complicated, more modern GPT-3 generator. However, it shows that the problem persists. It again has problem with narrator logic. We are told about person, and then this person went out and went along the road until he came to his own grave. The model simply has no idea that walking person do not have normally their own graves yet. Oh, and then she finally understood that she will never be able to treat her husband as an ugly woman. The system makes a simple error that humans never make. And that's the problem with using neural networks and embeddings for final conclusions. So we can use some, when constructing hybrid system, we really can use some insight from human brain. What parallels can we find in human brain for generative neural networks? And here comes research in studying intuition. If we look at the tasks that are typically used for studying human intuition and creativity, like solving anagrams, matchstick arithmetic, and so on, we can see that those tasks share some common properties. And the most important property is that any solution is easy to verify. You can say if the answer is correct at a glance. But typically, to trigger intuition, there is a lot of possible candidate solutions, so the person can just iterate consciously over all of them. But this easiness to verify is a very interesting feature. We have a known example from mathematician Poincaré that intuition can give good-looking prospective solutions that prove wrong when inspected thoroughly with logic, which is very similar to the problem that generative neural networks have. Good-looking solutions, but something is wrong when looking possible. So, what can be the initial role of logical or symbolic reasoning in human intelligence? We, as Sychev, developed a big capabilities for making long causal conclusions, a sequence of conclusions, and planning our actions accordingly. But this comes at a cost. It takes a lot of learning to introduce maths and logics to children, and not all people take it well. Some learn well, some learn not well. This means that this is not likely the first function of logical reasoning. It's something we as people put it to use later. What is natural to logical reasoning? And here we come to assessing believability. So my hypothesis was that human reasoning evolved as a way to verify the intuition and conclusions from intuition according to the world model, a way to weed out problematic solution that the intuition and the generative creative part gives up, because there is one big distinction between human and most artificial intelligence systems that are used for experimenting. If a neural network makes a big error, the researchers say, oh, that's bad. If a human makes a big error, the human dies and stops learning and cannot transfer their experience with. So we need a lot of safety features. And so reasoning that is not evident in many neural systems evolved, can be evolved as a conservative safety reason. If we look at human intelligence, checking for believability, it serves as a part of a lot of reasoning. Actually, even simple tasks of natural language understanding, like dealing with homonymy, anaphora resolution, dealing with ambiguous syntax constructs, they all depend on assessing believability. When interpreting a sentence that can be interpreted in several ways, we simply choose the most believable meaning. And so it can be projected to more complex tasks like common quotient equation answering, like assessing believability of stories that are told to us by other people, and generated ideas are often or different. But this process of taking for believability is very evident in human reasoning, and it is almost absent in artificial intelligence. So my proposal and direction of future research is making a new kind of hybrid neural symbolic architecture, where neural networks would serve as generative part, generating object, conclusions, texts, pictures, and so on, while logical symbolic reasoner would be used for constraint taking and reading out wrong solution, and found constraint violation can be used to teach neural network to improve the system intuitivity better. So this will allow for this artificial intelligence system to have some standard to avoid generating throughout creativity a too wrong, too problematic results. And this can be controlled by people controlling the logical constraints in the taker. So the system will be more trustable, that it don't come to some wild and different conclusion. But if we look at our current common sense knowledge graph, we found that they are poorly suited for that purpose. Mostly they contain a lot of facts of what is possible, but they work in open world assumption, and if something is not recorded, we can't say if it is impossible or if not recorded. Let's use a concept net, a famous MIT project, as example. A dog is capable of. We know that a dog can bark, be a pet, and play frisbee, but can the dog meow? ConceptNet doesn't give us any answer on it. Can a dog keep a pet? What sort of plane please be drawing or catching? What is more interesting, looking deeply, we find some entry stage. The dog is capable of sleeping a long time, but nothing at all about sleeping a short time and how long. The dog can jump over a log, but nothing about jumper over other objects, and nothing even if dog is capable to sit. That is a rather common norm. The most probably ridiculous fact recorded in ConceptNet about a dog is that a dog can win a blue ribbon, but there are no facts about other kind of ribbons or other kinds of proud dogs win a blue ribbon. It shows that the system was created unsystematically, and there is no explanatory information. It just records facts. Why is capable or why is not capable is not recorded, and there is no way to draw the border between what a dog really is capable of is not. Another common problem is using quantifiers. When a concept net says a dog is capable of something, does it mean every dog or some dogs? For some facts, like pulling a sleigh, it's clearly some dogs. Not every dog can pull a sleigh, but every dog can run, bark, wear a collar, and there is no difference in concept net between those facts. So this requires building new kinds of symbolic knowledge the knowledge that will be concerned with determining if something is possible and likely. And for the kinds of problems that are not likely but possible, it is useful to find boundary condition, not just a probability or that a random dog can pull a sledge, but boundary condition, which kinds of dog can pull a sledge, a special subclasses creating for this, and concentrating on rules between possible and impossible instead of simply storing collection of possible facts. So for something that is impossible, it is often useful to store a reason because there are too many facts that are impossible. For example, we can store that drawing an object requires hands, and so we know that dogs, fish, cats cannot draw a frisbee because they don't have hands. Without drawing separate facts for drawing a frisbee, drawing a vase, drawing a stone, and so on. The likely method for creating such common sense knowledge graphs and ontologies will be crowdsourcing because the ability to assess believability is so great and so ingrained in our minds that we have little writing knowledge on what is impossible. We just assess it naturally and don't have so much need to write it in sources like Wikipedia, BubbleNet, and so on. But a game can be designed like teaching an alien or a robot about life on Earth, that ask question if something is possible and why it is possible or why it is impossible. And using similar gaze, we can teach a new generation of common sense knowledge system, which will be capable to serve as constraint checkers for AI systems. Thank you for your attention. Any questions?
Okay, thank you. Couple of questions. Are you sure that your proposal is novel? If you come to your second slide, I believe that you propose to create a hybrid system consisting of a generative network and a critic, some kind of logical selector of by evaluating the quality of the result. I believe there are systems that are co-evolving, like a neural network co-evolving together with a critic and producing better better results. Or maybe they are not hybrid.
There is a lot of, actually, even GPT-2 and GPT-3 were all created using this model, a neural network with a critic. The problem is they use another neural network as a critic.
And you want
so
to use logical
it has the same vulnerability. It slips off the same logical problem.
And nobody tried to use logical evaluation.
As you can see from the end of my, we even don't have enough symbolic knowledge to try it. Our knowledge bases for symbolic knowledge are not suited well for it. So there is even not enough knowledge. There are similar approaches in neural modeling for when it comes for safe exploration, as I hypothesized. It was always tied to safety. So in some works of safe exploration, they try to map neural networks to logical strategy and then map it back. But they don't use this strategy as an externally verified checker. There is a lot of problems in this approach from creating a necessary base of facts and knowledge and to creating parsers and the way, because it's very easy with neural to generate networks, to generate text or images, but to make those images as input to logical constraint taker. We need to recognize them, to parse, to build formal models, and this, again, is the second barrier. But the most important barrier is the problems we simply do not store this knowledge in formal way for now.
Okay, thank you. Does anybody else have questions? No? Well, thank you very much for your talk.